Good evening and welcome to Our Lady of Peace. Our opening hymn is number 407. Again, we keep the solemn feast, number 407. Please rise.
So as we come before the Lord at this Mass, let us ask him for his mercy. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mystery. Have mercy on us, O Lord.
For we have sinned against you.
Show us, O Lord, your mercy.
And grant us your salvation.
May Almighty God have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Go over there and find the people. God who had set up Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled there and tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord in our midst or not?" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
nothing in common with Samaritans. Jesus answered and said to her, if you knew the gift of God, and who is saying to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water. The woman said to him, sir, you do not even have a bucket, and the cistern is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this cistern and drank from it himself with his children and his flocks? Jesus answered and said to her, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I shall give will never thirst. The water I shall give will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. The woman said to him, sir, give me this water, so that I may not be thirsty, or have to keep coming here to draw water. Jesus said to her, go call your husband and come back. The woman answered and said to him, I do not have a husband. Jesus answered her, you are right in saying, I do not have a husband. For you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true. The woman said to him, sir, I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you people say that the place to worship is in Jerusalem. Jesus said to her, believe me, woman, the hour is coming, and you will worship the Father, neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You people worship what you do not understand. We worship what we understand, because salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and is now here, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. And indeed the Father seeks such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. The woman said to him, I know that the Messiah is coming, the one called the Christ. When he comes, he will tell us everything. Jesus said to her, I am he, the one speaking. At that moment, his disciples returned and were amazed that he was talking with the woman. But still no one said, what are you looking for? Or why are you talking with her? The woman left her water jar and went into the town and said to the people, come see a man who told me everything I have done. Could he possibly be the Christ? They went out of the town and came to him. Meanwhile, the disciples urged him, Rabbi, eat. But he said to them, I have food to eat of which you do not know. So the disciples said to one another, could someone have brought you something to eat? Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of the one who sent me and to finish his work. Do you not say, in 4 months the harvest will be here? I tell you, look up and see the fields ripe for the harvest. The reaper is already receiving payment to gather the crops for eternal life, so that the sower and reaper can rejoice together. For here the saying is verified that one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done the work, and you are sharing the fruits of their work. Many of the Samaritans of that town began to believe in him because of the word of the woman who testified, who told me everything I have done. When the Samaritans came to him, they invited him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. Many more began to believe in him because of his word, and they said to the This passage about the woman at the well is obviously a writing passage, a striking passage, and it's one that I can remember very clearly the first time I really reflected deeply and learned a lot about the scripture passage. Because I had a theology teacher in college who read this very same passage the first day of class, and then he said at the end of the passage, after he was done reading it, that in all the different topics we were going to cover in the theology class, like it's an introductory class, so we were going to cover a lot of topics. So in all the topics we were going to cover, he was going to tie them back to something in this passage of the woman at the well. And sure enough, he did. The whole semester, every single class period, came back to something of this passage of the woman at the well. Obviously, we don't have time to go into all of those things, and I don't even remember all of them, but it's what I remember about diving deeply into a passage, perhaps for the first time. But what I want to look at today is this woman at the well, specifically her relationships. Her relationship, first of all, with Jesus, and then those in the town. Obviously, there's that issue of the relationships of the men in her life as well, but those other two in particular I want to look at. Now, the Lord Jesus, as he speaks to her, it becomes very clear very quickly that Jesus is not concerned about having water to drink, even though that's the first thing he asks her about, right? He's not concerned with getting a drink of water himself. He's not primarily concerned with her getting water to drink. After all, you might say, why not? You know, it's the middle of the day, it's arid land, why would you not be concerned with that? But again, we have the first reading, which perhaps seems like a long time ago, but we have the first reading how God gave people water from a rock to drink. So Jesus, obviously, his main concern isn't having water to drink. He could provide that at a moment's notice. Rather, what he's doing is he's beginning a conversation with her so that he can gently and gradually bring the conversation to deeper levels as we see happening over the course of the passage. And what he's trying to do is he's trying to gradually lead her to repentance, to open up her heart to him, to the waters of life, the living waters. Living waters can refer to just springs of water or flowing water. But of course, Jesus is concerned with that water of life. He himself, his grace, his life that he wants to give. And so we see that Jesus is doing this because he loves her. And he wants to give her this living water. He wants her to receive that life. And this reminds us of what we hear in the second reading, that Christ loved us while we were yet sinners. She wasn't even thinking of things on the same level as he. She didn't even know that he knew about her sins at that point. But Jesus did, and he loved her still. He loved her, and he loves us while we are yet sinners. And this love of God is an intense love that throughout the course of the history of God's people, especially the Jews, was always imagined in terms of marriage. Right? His love was so strong that the only image was that of marriage. And there's themes of that in this reading today, though we, perhaps in our culture, don't pick them up. But for the Jews, they knew from the scriptures that every time a prophet or a patriarch, when they met their wives, it was almost always at a well. And so the image of having Jesus there, this woman there at a well, would have called that to mind. Of course, this is not about them being married in a human way. It's about God's love for us. But perhaps it helps explain the disciples' shock when they come back and see Jesus talking with her, and they say, why is he speaking with her? And why is he talking with a woman? And a lot of times we jump right to cultural differences when we hear that, but the fact of the matter is that Jesus is portrayed throughout the gospel, especially John, talking with women, Martha, Mary Magdalene, and all these other women. And so it's not so much he's talking with a woman, but perhaps they got this imagery of the well, the man and the woman at the well also. And that's why they were questioning, surprised that the Lord was speaking to her in that way. But at any rate, to return to his love, right? His love for her. I think it's important to notice her sin does not block his love, right? Her sin does not prevent him from loving her. It has nothing to block it. Jesus starts the conversation, as I said, and leads her deeper. He's constantly drawing her deeper and deeper into that. So time of harvest so that we are not locked in loving in return and receiving his love. And so we see this relationship, first of all, with Jesus, that over time she does open her heart to him, and she does receive that living water. She leaves her jar behind as after she comes to that realization. Now, something also been noted that this woman comes at noon time to draw water, which is not the normal time people would come to draw water. She's coming separately from everyone else in the community, and so they know her isolation from the community, perhaps also because of her sin, right? She would have been known as a public sinner, and so perhaps was kind of isolated from the community because of that as well. And this is an important thing for us as well. It obviously shows us something about her relationships, but it shows us something about ourselves as well, that more than anything else, it's sin that isolates us. It's a lot of thought about isolation, of course, this time, and distancing, and all those sorts of things, right? And that can be painful and all of that. But more than that, sin is what isolates us. But, again, this gospel is about what Jesus does as well, and more importantly, and Jesus unites us. Jesus unites us. So, after this woman who is kind of separated, not integrated into the town, coming out by herself to draw water, after she encounters Jesus, his love, after she opens her heart to his love and can love him in return, all of a sudden then she goes and brings the whole town out to Jesus. Now, instead of being separated from them, she's bringing all of them to Christ. And so again, in this time when various levels of isolation or distancing are being called for in order to limit the spread of disease, let's remember that in the midst of the sacrifices and the trials that may indeed involve, that we remain deeply united in Jesus. We remain deeply united in Jesus through prayer, through worship, through opening up our hearts to him and his love and loving him in return. And so in order for that to be possible, let us listen for his voice. Let us harden not our hearts, and let us receive that living water of his love, which he wishes to pour into our lives. Let's profess our faith using the Apostles' Creed on the back of the worship book. I believe in God, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven. God gives us the living water, our true salvation. Let us pray to the Father for all who thirst for his divine life.
That they may turn to him and know his loving mercy.
loving Father, through Jesus we have entered the life of grace, and your Spirit has been poured into our hearts. Receive the prayers we offer in faith. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. As we enter our fourth reading, scripture number 622, I heard the voice of Jesus say, number 622.
Holy
are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. But through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that with the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm our faith and charity in the Pilgrim Church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, Bernard, our Bishop, Andrew, his assistant, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, for whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Give
from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
The kingdom of our glory is
now. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
On you stay.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should come to my roof, but only say the word and this soul shall be healed.
Easter time, 417.
Let us pray. As we receive the pledge of things yet hidden in heaven and are nourished while still on earth with the bread that comes from on high, we humbly entreat you, O Lord, that what is being brought about in us in history may come to true completion. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A little tough to do announcements when we're trying to just navigate day to day what is going to be happening, what we're going to keep, what we're not going to keep doing. But just want to say as a general thing, we have several goals in mind when it comes to this coronavirus. We want to not contribute to the spirit of fear or panic. We want to keep providing the sacraments as best we can and to do our part to limit the spread of this disease or any disease. So, in case you haven't heard, know that the Archbishop has dispensed people from their Sunday obligation. He has a letter that's available online that explains that those who choose to take advantage of that opportunity should make Sunday a day of prayer nonetheless. He gives some examples of ways to do so, the rosary, reading the readings from Mass, the liturgy of the hours. He included the Mass times that TV and radio broadcasts of the Mass are held. There's that out there for you, and so know of that. Bears repeating that if you are feeling sick, please stay home. Illness is always a permissible reason to miss Mass, not just now. So we do plan to continue with, again, as many liturgies and especially smaller events as we can. However, cancellations so far do include our second fish fry, and the faith formation trip to feed my starving children this coming Wednesday, since they have closed their facility for most of this coming week. I would encourage you to check the website, email, social media, whatever you use to stay connected with us for updates. If there are people you know that don't have access to those means of communication, would you please either let us know, or if you could help us out by passing any changes or information onto them. Our staff is doing a great job working on being flexible and creative when it comes to making adjustments, and we just ask for your patience as we do so. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing. Direct, O Lord, we pray, the hearts of your faithful, and in your kindness grant your servants this grace, that abiding in the love of you and their neighbor, they may fulfill the whole of your commands. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth, the Mass is ended.